That wonderful lunch that was provided here this afternoon. I know I was ready for it, hadn't eaten anything yet today. My name is Jason Kessler. I work with NC New Schools Breakthrough Learning. And welcome to the afternoon lightning talk round. Today we will have four presenters who will come up and provide you with a overview of their organization and how it relates to the classroom and careers of the future. But before I introduce these wonderful folks who've taken time to come here today, let me remind you that the session materials and handouts are available on the mobile app for this conference. If you have questions, please jot those down. At the conclusion of the four presentations, we will have time for you to ask those questions to our presenters. And if you do need anything throughout the session, raise your hand. I will see what I can do to help you. And we also have materials up here that you may take with you on the table, some handouts, looks like some books over there, a lot of nice materials to take with you today, and you may take those at the conclusion of our session. Today, our first presenter is going to be Mr. Ed Ross from the Core Results Incorporated. Mr. Ross is over here. We also have with us Lisa Marshall from NC State University Department of Nuclear Engineering. We have Joseph Bridger from Stewart Acoustical Consultant and Jim Jetter from US EPA. I don't know if I've ever been to a conference where Department of Nuclear Engineering and EPA were at the same place, but that it was always the first time for everything. But enough about trying to make jokes, and I'll let Mr. Ross begin his presentation. Thanks, Jason.
The title of this session is You Deserve to Know. You deserve to know that in classrooms across the U.S., there are students who cannot focus on their studies because they're concerned about what's happening back at home while they're in school. You deserve to know that in classrooms across the U.S., there are lists of students who don't learn in the traditional way, yet they're required to learn according to a standard that's preset for them. You deserve to know that there are others who don't feel that there's enough budget or that the purpose is to design a curriculum that drives toward a specific metric that they feel is important. Some of you may be reading the slide and you may be thinking, no, he didn't just put that up there. Or maybe it doesn't sound like that in your head. Maybe your question is, did he really just put that up there? And my answer to you is unequivocally, yes. I am the son of a woman who was born in Robinsonville, North Carolina on October 10th, 1939. My mother is what some would consider functionally illiterate. She was raised in a home where making ends meet was more important than education. So in the third grade, she was removed from school and forced to help the family tend the fields to offset the cost of living in their homes. Now, some people may look at that and say there's no way that this woman would raise six children who all went on to be successful in their own right, some as police officers, detectives, electricians, and the youngest, who seems to think that he can change the world if we can open up a dialogue around measuring performance in a different way than what we've come to know it as. My name is Ed Ross. I'm the CEO and president of the Core Results. And today, over the next 10 minutes, we're going to have an engaging discussion around changing the way we look at measuring performance. And our organization believes that we've come up with a way to change this dialogue in such a way that we can change the conversation around what is the most important attribute when we're engaging with students. Is it knowledge? Is it skill? or is it ability?
So, as I was saying, what did you end up majoring in compared to what you thought you were going to be when you grew up? Maybe it's time that we stop asking this question, what do you want to be when you grow up? And as Jamie says, you start asking questions like this. What problems do you want to solve? How would that change the context of the conversation? Or perhaps we even take that a step further and we say, what are the knowledge, skills, and ability you're going to need to solve that problem? And this rings true for exactly what my organization does. Myself and my partner sat down and we're having a conversation in a professional environment around assessing how a team goes from training to performance. And one of the phrases that we've coined is we say there's a gap between training and performance. We provide information. We provide and focus on knowledge, skill, and ability. Yet there's a quiet period until we can actually measure that. And for us, we started to think about this whole cascade of knowledge, skill, and ability, and what is it to transfer into. And as I was discussing at lunch with a gentleman by the name of Polk, often as educators, both professionally and in the institutions, we focus on knowledge and skill more heavily than anything else. Do they know it? Can they do it? Do they know it? Can they do it? We test, we drive toward metrics and standards around do they know it, can they do it. We've taken a different approach, and we'd like to think that ability is perhaps the most important standard to measure. And I'm going to advance the screen here, and I will show you how we think about this. When you think about knowledge, skill, or ability, we like to think of it playing out as such. Knowledge is simple. It's what we know. Skill is how we apply what we know. Ability is our potential to apply what we know. Did anyone catch the difference there? Ability is the potential to apply what we know. So often as educators, we're challenged and forced to think about ability as actually application of knowledge and skill. When in reality, the ability is, can they do it, given the right circumstances or situation? Our algorithm helps us measure how well individuals, organizations, can apply and convert that into performance. Now, we do that in a pretty unique way. The algorithm takes a look at some subjective elements and then some objective elements that are predefined in the system, and that allows us to convert that into two different types of results. One is a quantitative result where we can actually give a physical score based on what we're observing. The other is a qualitative result where we actually can give indications around how well someone is developing or performing against a certain standard. Here's the challenge. If we think back to our conversation earlier and what Jamie says, we know that in order to keep up in today's world where technology is at hand, learners learn differently, we're required to drive metrics and standards according to rules that are predefined, we need to have a new generation of communicators and collaborators and critical thinkers. It's no longer just sufficient for them to be able to recall the answer to something. The real challenge is, can we actually do it? Can we actually do it? And I'll take you back to the story that I shared very, very earlier today about my mom. Many people would look at someone who wasn't able to read and think that that person is destined or predestined to an outcome of relying on the government or needing additional help. The beauty of the story is, as I said to you, she raised six children who all went on to be successful in their own right. She went on to work in a hospital, of all places, in a key role within a hospital, never having the ability to read. Now, I'll ask you that question. How was that possible? Did she rely on knowledge? No. Did she rely on skill? To some extent. Did she rely on ability? Absolutely. While she was pulled out of school in the third grade and later returned at the age of 13. Let me slow down. I don't think some of you caught it. She was pulled out of school, forced to go work to support the family, and then put back in school at the age of 13 in the third grade. For her, it wasn't about knowledge. It wasn't about skill. It was about the ability to apply what she knew and had learned in life. Now, while I'm glad those days are gone by and they don't exist anymore, I will challenge each of you to stop and think for a moment. In your role, in the system that you're provided, are you only focused on knowledge and skill? Or do you have the dexterity to focus on the ability, not what they know, not how they apply what they know, but how do they apply what they know when it matters? When we designed this tool, we wanted to do a few things. We wanted to make sure that the tool was easy to use. It is a cloud-based application. We wanted to make sure that it could assess development as well as performance, and what are the key metrics that allow us to get there. We wanted to make sure that we could identify where someone was strong and when someone needed a little bit more assistance, perhaps that assistance that came from outside the classroom. And then we wanted to make sure that we could articulate that in a way that we could coach behaviors that would lead to that ultimate ability, which is performance. Doing what matters, doing applying knowledge and skill when it matters most. So in closing, I'd like to say this. I recognize that many of you invest your time, your resources, and your talent to get students beyond where they are and beyond where the curriculum says they should be. I'll ask you after this presentation to start thinking differently about the impact of knowledge and skill and focus more on ability, because as Jamie said, in order to take us to where we need to be, we'll need critical thinkers that can go beyond the paper that they have in front of them. Thank you very much for your time.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lisa Marshall. I'm the Director for Outreach, Retention, and Engagement for the Nuclear Engineering Department at NC State. And I want to talk a little bit about energy education and its critical role overall and how nuclear engineering, nuclear energy in particular, is part of one of the grand challenges that we have facing us today. Our program here at NC State is one of the oldest in the nation, and we also have the first non-governmental research reactor as well. I'm going to spend some time talking a little bit about nuclear energy and kind of putting it into context as to, well, exactly how that whole process goes about, and then also a spotlight on North Carolina, on the nation as a whole, and how it fits in globally, and then some of the resources that you can pull on. On the top of that list, of course, is the department itself and reaching out to myself. I've got a number of classroom activities, various resources, videos, games, various activities that one can plug into, and it's as simple as getting in contact with me with regards to that. In addition, an invitation to come and visit our research reactor and see what our students are doing and where the research is heading. Saying all of that, I'm going to move over here. And please excuse me, I do this quite a bit. I talk about a slide that I'm about to put up. So kind of this is the roadmap that I'm going to be following. So it's looking at nuclear energy unplugged, so to speak. In the United States, we are using uranium-235 as our fuel source. And there, if I were to go outside and take a sample, I would find a certain concentration of it in the soil sample itself. When you look globally, though, these are where the reserves are located, with the largest being in Canada, Saskatchewan in particular, and then also in Australia. Right now, most of our uranium is coming from an agreement with the former Soviet Union. We're taking the program itself is known as megatons to megawatts. They've renamed it. And I haven't put that one to memory quite just yet, but if you were to Google megatons to megawatts, you would see a write-up on it. So we're taking nuclear warheads and downgrading it, so from a high enrichment to 4 to 5% enrichment, so that then it could be used for energy production. In the United States, you're looking at the bulk of our reserves coming from out west. So you're looking at North Dakota, South Dakota, Wyoming, Texas area, and then slowly moving across. There was going to be one in Danville, Virginia. They're still doing some research work there to see if it's actually viable to have a uranium mining set up in that location. So we wait, I'll wait. So what are we doing? So if you look at the upper, I guess it would be your right-hand side, you have one of the uranium ores. You can still go prospecting for this in New Mexico area. But as you can imagine, there are a number of other elements within it, and we're interested in uranium in particular. It is 0.7% naturally occurring, and we have to enrich it to that 4 to 5%. So what we're going to do is to, oops. No pointer. Okay, so mining for it, then we're going to convert it to uranium hexafluoride. We're going to enrich it from that 0.7 to 4 to 5%. We're going to reconvert it to uranium dioxide, and then we're going to make it into pellets. And then there's going to be a series of those pellets that go into the rod, and a series of those rods that make up the fuel assembly. And depending on the reactor that it is associated with, it can be as small as 2 feet by about 2 feet, which is ours. We have 25 of these pins. So the lower left-hand or right-hand picture is showing you a top-down of our research reactor as it's operating. And the top one is giving you a photograph of what our facility looks like at NC State at the Burlington Labs. So what's happening subatomically? So we're playing pool, so to speak. Uranium-235, we're bombarding it with neutrons. It's splitting apart, and we're then going to harness that energy that is released for our energy production. I put some interesting information down there below, and I believe I'll leave this slide for you to have access to. But if we were to burn, and I use burn in quotes, because you're not going to be burning uranium, but you're actually fissioning it or splitting it apart. If we have 2.2 pounds of the respective fuels, for coal you'll need, if you were going to power a 100 watt light bulb, 4 days with the burning. Natural gas, you're looking at 6 days. But if you're going to use uranium, the uranium pellets that we have, you're looking at 140 years. So the energy density is quite high when comparing the various fuel sources. So there are two types of light water reactors here in the United States with that enrichment. The top one is a pressurized water reactor, and the bottom one is the boiling water reactor. About 75% of the market is the top one, the pressurized water reactor. There are five of these reactor sites here in the in North Carolina, accounting for 32% of our power. So when you look nationally, you're looking at 19.9%. Internationally, you're looking at 16%. Within North Carolina, the blend or the energy mix is slightly different and raises us to 32%. South Carolina, you're looking at 56% of its power coming from nuclear power plants. So the closest one to here is the Sharon Harris one, and that's the pressurized water reactor version. And then when we look in nationally, there are 99 reactors that are amounting to that 99.9%. And a picture here of of our reactor. So if I could just kind of show you. All right, so the dome-like structure is where you've got your core reactor and where the fission reaction is occurring. You know, the symbolic, if one were to Google, you've got the cooling tower that is typically shown. Plants such as this will be supplying energy to approximately 250 to 300,000 homes. In way of your global nuclear power plants, there are about 438 in operation right now in 30 countries, and you've got about 60 to 65 in construction plants worldwide, with the largest number of constructions happening in Asia. There are 29 planned or under construction ones in various parts of China. They do very big mega projects, so you've got your various dams, you've got coal-fired power plants, and then nuclear power plants, and renewables, so either your wind farms or your solar farms as well that are under construction. The one design that's leading the way is the AP1000, and that's a pressurized water reactor version, and this has been put out by Westinghouse. So a smaller footprint, more efficient fuel, and I put up here the bottom part of a reactor vessel that is part of the Sanmen facility that is under construction, along with a map of where within China we have those 29 either planned or under construction sites. Now, within the United States, we have, do I have a picture of that? I may have passed it. So within the United States, there are five plants that are under construction. There are two at the Vogtle site in Georgia, two at the VC Summer site in South Carolina, and then the Watts Bar unit in Tennessee, which belonged to Tennessee Valley Authority. That one never went online, and they decided that it was time for it to go online. It was used as a training location, and that should go on onto the grid system within the next few months, if it has not already done so in the last couple of days. So there are some issues associated with nuclear power plants and its operation, whether here in the United States or globally. And one of them is the spent fuel pools. What are we going to do with it? Right now, all of the plants within the United States are holding their fuel in what is known as spent fuel pools. Some have gone to dry canisters that are also on site at these particular nuclear power plants. So the top one is giving you a look into one of what the spent fuel pools would look like, and the picture right underneath it is a dry cask storage on site as well. The other two pictures that are here are from Yucca Mountain. This was being studied for the last 20 plus years. It was halted when President Obama took office. There have been a number of legal challenges to having a spent fuel national repository in Nevada next to the Nevada test site. It has been studied, and this was one of the locations that had been chosen. A result of some of the court challenges, where it's that we would continue to do the research and expend the monies that has been set aside for the research work to be completed. The idea overall was to house all of our spent fuel, from military and non-military usage in this location. I'm using the word spent fuel as opposed to nuclear waste, because there is still energy that is in our spent fuel that can be used for another type of reactor. We have not closed our fuel cycle. Instead, we're a one-through system right now. So that spent fuel that would be housed at Yucca Mountain or in the spent fuel pools or in the canister, dry cask canisters, could potentially be used by another type of reactor that we haven't built in the United States quite just yet. In way of reprocessing, France has been doing that to reduce the amount of radioisotopes that need to be stored safely. And that has increased overall their usage of nuclear energy to 77% compared to us here in the United States as 19.9. So the research work that we're doing at NC State relates to everything along the fuel cycle. Either you're looking at the uranium fuel cycle or you're looking at the nuclear fuel cycle overall. For the next generation of reactors and getting a better understanding of what do we do with the spent fuel? What do we do in way of a smaller footprint? How can energy education be, I don't like to use the word perfected, but enhanced both here in the United States and abroad. And there are other applications of the technology that we are plugged into as well, whether you're looking at medical applications or other industrial applications of the technology. I wanted to say that there are two consortia that we are now funding to do primary research and development. One is CASEL, the Consortium of Advanced Simulation of Light Water Reactors. So we're taking the fuel codes coming from the AP1000 that Westinghouse is doing, and we are making it more efficient. We're also in the process of building a virtual reactor at Oak Ridge National Laboratory that will be used for educational purposes, both by industry and by the educational environment. We also have, most recently, CNEC, which is the Consortium for Nonproliferation Enabling Capabilities. So what we're trying to do there is to, if we have highly enriched radioisotopes that are being used in industrial settings and we can find an alternative for them, we're looking to switch them out. We're also looking at nuclear security. As we use the technology, there are states as well as non-state actors who would like to get their hands on it for other uses than peaceful. How then do we detect the movement of radioisotopes, both for positive as well as negative? And as you can imagine, individuals and states are masking the actual amount of radioactive materials that they are utilizing. So then how then do we detect it without slowing legitimate trade that is occurring across various borders? So those two projects are funded by the Department of Energy as well as the National Nuclear Security Administration, and we are either the lead or one of the founding members in the consortium that's working in this area. How can you get involved? How can your students get involved? Well, I extend an invitation, and please tell others about our science in visit as well as on campus and off campus visits that can occur. Either myself or some of the student ambassadors in our program are more than willing to engage with your students, either as a grouping, as one class, or a series of classes. We'd love to have you come and visit our research reactor and find out more about the non-destructive material analysis that we're doing in our program. Another is the Young Investigators Summer Program that's open to rising juniors and rising seniors. They come on campus and live for 3 weeks in one of the dorms, and then we take them through lectures, labs, small group projects, and some of the companies or some of the areas that I've mentioned will actually go and visit and find out from alumni and also other professionals how they can plug in to energy education here in the RTP area. And then we have Science Teachers Workshop. It's a 2-day workshop in the end of June, and this is open to science and math high school teachers for them to come onto campus for that first day and actually engage in a number of lab activities and hear about some of the research work and how that then can be plugged into the curriculum that you all are teaching, whether it be chemistry, physics, environmental science, environmental studies, etc. So there are many ways to plug in. These are just highlights of some of the things that we are engaged with. If you can think of something outside of this box, we're more than and willing to engage and see if we can make this happen. So with our program, and in 12 minutes, I can't tell you all about it, so I decided to focus in on nuclear energy in particular. But our program covers fission, also radiation applications and detection, as well as fusion engineering and plasma science as well. Plasma science is more related to nanofabrication, some textiles work that we do. Our students then are engaged from the bachelor's program all the way through to the PhD, and they are hired by a number of companies, both in this footprint within North Carolina and throughout the US and internationally. So I named a few, Duke being the one energy company that has the largest fleet of nuclear reactors in that particular fleet. Dominion is at the border with Virginia, a number of the national laboratories. You're looking at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission as well. And then you have a number of engineering firms ranging from Westinghouse that I mentioned, Areva, also GE Hitachi down in Wilmington has their headquarters there, Bechtel. The shipyard as well will hire our students, U.S. Navy. We have a number of students that then become commissioned officers upon completion of their bachelor's degree with us. Medical supply companies, some students go on to law degrees. They're interested in environmental law or contracts. Some have gone on to pharmacy school, to vet school. Others have done the MBA route because they're looking to work in your executive track at any one of these companies or organizations. So there are many kind of avenues for students that they can follow upon completion of an energy degree, and I chose to focus in, since I belong to the nuclear engineering department, to focus in on nuclear energy in particular. Last slide. Various sources, right? So the American Nuclear Society, I am their vice chair for communications as well as their immediate past chair for the education, training, and workforce development division. And we have been working quite hard on the nuclearconnect.org. This is a resource for educators overall, as well as there is a section for policymakers, and just in general public, individuals who are interested in the technology and finding out a little bit more about the various applications. If you wish to assist in making this a more rich site for these various uses, please feel free to let me know. We also would love to have feedback on its content. There are a number of other resources here, such as Case Energy, more on the politics side or public policy side of things. Our department, of course, Nuclear Energy Institute, it's a collaboration of a trade organization of your nuclear energy organizations. And then also you've got the Nuclear Regulatory Commission that has an educational component on their site as well. So.
Okay. Joe Bridger, Joseph Bridger is almost looking up online. That's the best way to find me. I'm a Stewart Acoustical Consultants, graduated at NC State, and a master's in mechanical engineering and acoustics. And I'm one of those kids who loved engineering but loved music too. So that's how I got involved in the field. And we deal a lot with schools. And over the last 15 years or so, classroom acoustics has been one of the big issues that has been developed. A lot of people, when they think about classrooms, they think about, well, it's not an auditorium, it's not a worship space. What's the big deal? You know, why is this important? You know, is it really that big a problem? So that's what this is to address, is to help you understand the backdrop of why we're concerned about the acoustical environment in a classroom. Okay. So what are some of the problems? We're going to go over that, and we're going to talk about how the problems have developed over the last several decades, and what we need to do to improve the classrooms. Okay? And then lastly, we'll bring up a standard that has been developed to address those problems. Okay, so first we need to understand what's going on, right? So the goal of a teacher, hopefully, is that the students are understanding what's being said when you're doing lecture style. Obviously, there's many styles of learning, but when you're trying to communicate over distance, especially, you need that child to be able to understand what's being said, okay? And there are things that influence that ability. One of them is background noise, such as my projector here. So if I was a kid sitting next to here, that might be a problem. But otherwise, out there, it's not so bad, right? And then there's something called reverberation time, which has to do with how sound decays in the room. So we're going to discuss that, those two factors, and focus in on this thing called speech intelligibility. And how does that really influence learning? So a lot of research was done by folks a couple decades ago who were interested in this problem. And the pointer on this is what? The middle button. So the black or darker lines here are adults, okay? And if you go to the right, where I am, or left, no, that's the right, where I am, this is more intelligible speech. So I can understand things better. AI, I don't want to get into all the descriptions of all the numbers and everything. It gets a little crazy. But the bottom line is, I'm supposed to understand things better way over here on the right side. And things are supposed to not be so well understood on the left side. But then we got something else called percentage of correct words. How well in this environment they are really understanding things. And one thing you're going to see here is an adult can understand 90% of the words at a 0.4 of what we call articulation index. But anyway, that's how well an adult can understand. But if you look at a young child, a five-year-old, to get the same performance, they have to be way over here on the right. So children have a different ability to understand speech in a given environment. They need a lot better, they need to make it easier for them to understand speech. Okay? So here's another one. Same kind of idea, okay? Adults are over here. This is age to the right, on the right. And then the threshold of how loud the person's speech is versus the noise that the background that they're in, where they start to understand things more clearly. So adults can really do a good job of reading lips or hearing in background sound because they've been trained to do that for a long time. Children, especially younger ages, who are still learning language, they don't understand so well in noise. Okay, it's a lot harder for them to pick out what it is you're saying. They need a lot more signal. They need to hear you better over the other sounds in the room. Okay, so then you extrapolate this out. You have different groups. One of the groups that's very big in North Carolina, I know, is where English is not your primary language. So if you come in here and that's not the language you grew up hearing, how well do you perform? Well, it's clear that inexperienced language users need even a higher signal to noise than other children do, okay? And this effect goes on. Here's some of the different conclusions. Young children in general need stronger signal over the noise in the room, and we'll talk about what that noise is in a minute, to understand clearly. And those whose English is a second language for them, they even need more than a younger kid would, okay? And then we have societal changes. There are students in the classroom who have slight hearing impairment. They've been mainstreamed, which is not a bad thing, but if you're going to do that, they need a better environment to hear in. So the general result is we need less reverberation, lower noise levels than traditionally we have thought, okay? So we're going to go in a little bit, dig a little bit deeper in the woods now. All right, so this is a decibel scale. You can find these all over Google. There's all kinds. All right, that give you an idea. Decibels is the way we measure noise levels. It's the way we hear and perceive things. And A-weighted is a fancy way of saying it's made to sound like us humans actually hear it. It's been filtered to better resemble how you actually hear things, okay? And you can get a different, you can see a soft whisper is 35 dBA, okay? versus a jet takeoff is way up here at 125, okay? Your vacuum cleaner in your home, somewhere in the mid-70s. So you get an idea, okay? So what's the scale on the right? Well, this is sound level, okay? And signal is the person who's trying to communicate. So that's the teacher, presumably in a classroom situation, or it could be a student who's raised their hand and said something the other students are trying to hear. And then the noise over here is whatever is not that signal that you're trying to hear. That could be mechanical systems noise, noise from outside, other kids talking, another classroom next door. Well, what we discovered, all that stuff we just showed you, is we really need about a 15 dB signal to noise ratio. That means the source level, how loud that is, has to be 15 dB louder than the background in the room. The problem is, whereas if I'm over here talking to this gentleman close, you know, he can hear me louder. Then the person, right now I got a microphone on, then first the person in the back row, okay? Some people think the solution is to amplify everything. I'm not going to get into that too much, but just to say, what if the student raises their hand and talks? Is that, how are they going to be able to hear, be heard? They don't have a microphone. So we're going to keep going. So let's break it down. So how do we get the noise down? The studies have shown that since the normal teacher's voice may be 50 dB at the back of the room, I need to get that background sound about 35 or less. So the principal sources we find in most schools are air conditioning systems. Now, you can make an air conditioning system quiet, but people don't generally think about that. Another thing is, how are your walls built? How are your windows? Are you near an airport? Are you near a train? You know, and the more urban setting you are in, obviously it becomes a bigger and bigger issue where your transportation noise sources are, where things are arranged around the room. Okay. So for that child to be able to, I'm obviously using an extreme example just to get the point, right? But we need to control how sound propagates from one room to another and from the outside to inside. So there's these ratings that you'll see that's in a standard that we're going to talk about later called STC, that's the speech transmission class, and then OITC, outdoor to indoor transmission class. What's that all about? It's rating how well does that wall block sounds, particularly this type of sources you're dealing with. Outside, it's more airplanes and trains and things like that. Indoors, it's more spoken voice, okay? But what is reverberation? Reverberation, okay. Even the microphone right now, you can hear my voice sort of echo a little bit. If you've ever been in an old-fashioned gym or a pool, indoor pool, a lot of those facilities will be a little more reverberant. You get too far away from somebody, you can't even understand what they're saying. Well, why is that? And what does that do with noise? Well, that rate of decay, how fast, how long it takes that sound to decay, okay? You have your speech signal, this is time going to the right. So I hear it, and then all the other stuff that comes in afterwards, okay? So your brain, the way it's wired, the first little bit you hear, it just puts all that together. Okay, that's speech. And it just puts it all together, and it's good stuff. All the late arriving stuff that comes later, okay, is just noise to the brain. It's just confusing. You've heard of an echo. An echo usually occurs as a sharp peak in that region. Your brain separates it out into two separate signals and you get confused. So the faster that sound decays, as we'll see in the next slide, the faster it decays, okay, that means the shorter the reverb time. That's the number of seconds it takes for the sound to decay. That shorter reverb time means I have more of this signal over here and less of this noise. That the brain, the part of the decay that your brain hears is noise. And I can understand better. I hear better. Okay, so the opposite is true. The longer the decay, the longer the reverb time, the lower the signal to noise, and the lower your speech intelligibility. Okay? So that's why we set a reverb time goal. Reverb time is how long it takes in seconds for something to decay. And we set a goal so that you can deliver that clear speech we're talking about. Okay, And we'll talk about specifically what those are in the end. So, in the old days, you didn't have air conditioning. You had good isolation because walls were generally masonry. But it was reverberant, so it wasn't an ideal environment. And they didn't really have a lot of background noise, though, because there was no air conditioning. But so there have been some changes. Now we've got acoustical ceilings a lot of times. And you have carpet on the floor. Some of that's gone away later years. Air conditioning was added. You had the open plan classroom, which might work okay when it's one-on-one. It does not work at all when you're trying to have different groups trying to listen with different teachers speaking and they're trying to communicate over a distance. So you had other changes that happened. We had air quality concerns. These are all good things. I mean, I want good air quality. Well, then you're throwing more air in a room. You're delivering more air into a room. That means you're going to produce potentially more noise if you don't pay attention to it. Also, there are restrictions on carpet and HVAC sounding. Some people saying we don't want carpet in our classroom, so you got less materials to absorb sound. Some people saying I don't want stuff in my ducts. I don't want no lining in the ducts. Well, now there's nothing between that fan and that room to silence the sound. Okay? And I would even add, this doesn't really talk about this, you got daylighting. Great idea. I mean, it's a good idea to have daylighting, but then you got this more cubic volume, and the more cubic volume you have, believe it or not, the reverb time, the reverberation goes up. Okay? So there's just more challenges created that have to be addressed. And now, even, people are taking out ceilings. They just want to have exposed deck. There's radiant ceiling systems. We're working on a school right now that has that. And so you have to pay attention to this. So what all this revolved is all these changes and the studies that people have done is there's a new standard, which there are a few copies there. It's an older version. And I think they handed out PDFs of the newer version. You can also download it for free. I'll show you how in a minute. But the basic goals are to lower reverberation to about 0.6, 0.7 seconds. You'll see that in this. That doesn't mean anything to anybody, but just remember those numbers. HVAC noise has been lowered about 35 dBA, and we're trying to make sure you have good isolation between classrooms so you're not competing with other classrooms. And we want to control the noise from the outside, especially the more urban setting you're dealing with. That becomes a bigger problem. That's what the standard looks like. Now, where do you go for resources? Well, there are books written where some of this material came from to help educate educators and people who build these buildings. Okay? And they're available at this website, Acoustical Society of America. You can either just Google Classroom Acoustic Standard, or you could visit acousticalsociety.org. It's right under Education and Outreach, Acoustics of Classrooms. And it has books for architects and for people who want to know the background information. So my goal in presenting this today is just to inform you, to help you understand that and all this great technology we're talking about and everything else, and as buildings are innovated and changed for to be more sustainable or whatever, this is an important goal to also achieve, to make sure that kids can understand what the teacher is saying. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jim Jetter, and I'm a research engineer. I work with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. I work on the EPA campus close by, right here in Research Triangle Park. And I have a BS degree in mechanical engineering from North Carolina State University, and I have a Master of Science degree in environmental engineering from the University of North Carolina. I'm a licensed professional engineer, and I'm a returned Peace Corps volunteer. I'd like to talk about clean cook stoves in this presentation. It's a little, maybe not something you hear too much about, especially from EPA. I was the first person in my family to go to college. And sometimes I think about how, you know, different my life has been compared with my grandparents' lives. And my grandparents were farmers, and they both had had an eighth grade educations. But that was not too unusual for their time in those days, and the place where they lived, a lot of people only went as far as the eighth grade. And Ed talked about how even more recently there's, you know, people that are in that category of not advancing that far with their educations. But I feel like I was very fortunate, because when I was a kid, I got to spend a lot of time with my grandparents on their farm. And I used to love to hear my grandparents tell stories about what life was like before they had electricity, or before they had running water in their home, before they had a tractor, before they had a car. When my grandparents were just starting a family and working on a new farm, my grandmother used to do all of the cooking on a wood-burning cook stove. And she used that wood-burning cook stove for canning vegetables. She'd can enough vegetables in the summertime to last the family all the way through the winter. And when I think about how different their lives were than the way that we live today, to me it seems kind of amazing that their life has changed so much. And I wonder, with your students, if they sometimes think about how amazing it is how life has changed so much in such a short period of history. And then another thing I think is amazing is that our way of life is so different from the way that people live in other parts of the world in our world today. And I wonder if your students think about that too. You know, the fact that the way we live is so different from the way that other people live in the world. And I wonder if your students are aware that that almost 3 billion people in the world, that's, you know, almost half of the world's population, these people are still cooking over open cooking fires, you know, and they're cooking on a daily basis over open cooking fires. The problem with this is that they're breathing smoke from these fires, continuously on a daily basis. And it's not, we're not talking about an occasional backyard barbecue here. We're not talking about an occasional campfire. We're talking about daily exposure to smoke. And in my grandparents' day, people did not understand that it was harmful to health to breathe in smoke from burning tobacco. But now we understand how harmful that is. And it wasn't until fairly recently that people around the world did not understand how harmful to health it was for people to be breathing smoke from cooking fires on a daily basis. But now we understand, and it turns out this is a huge global health problem. And it's a problem that is just that the world is just slowly becoming aware of now. So this is a new big problem that is out there, and that's what I want to talk about here. So I'd like to show you a 3-minute video. This was produced by the Voice of America, and I'd like to show it to you because I think it can give you a lot more information in 3 minutes than I can give you. So not sure. I know it's on the computer here. Yeah, we tried it before the presentation worked fine. There we go.
Open fires cook the food and heat the homes of 3 billion people. But where there's fire, there's smoke, and smoke kills. Indoor air pollution claims more than 4 million lives each year.
To put that in perspective, that's more deaths than HIV, AIDS, malaria, and tuberculosis combined.
Engineer Jim Jetter has been working for more than a decade on making cook stoves cleaner.
I felt like this was kind of a calling for me, really.
His lab at the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency tests new stove designs coming in from around the world. He says a lot more have arrived since 2010, when then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton helped launch the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves.
So when we started off to tackle this challenge, we believed, number one, it was a health challenge and an environmental challenge, but it also, if approached correctly, could be an economic opportunity.
companies making more efficient, less polluting stoves get backing from the Global Alliance. Cooker designs come in all shapes and sizes.
This is an institutional stove that's large enough for cooking food for a school or a hospital. This stove is used in Central America and Mexico, and it's used for making tortillas.
All these stoves aim to cook more cleanly and efficiently than conventional ones do.
But how do you know that they use less fuel, that they put out fewer pollutants? Well, it takes a lot of serious science to figure that out, and that's what EPA is doing here.
Each humble cook stove gets a full battery of high-tech analyses.
These measurements are very sensitive. If someone is standing next to that hood and breathing, it picks up the carbon dioxide in their breath.
Researchers take precise measurements of pollutants like nitrogen oxides and black carbon, or soot.
99.98, that's it.
They test how long it takes to boil a pot of water and how much fuel it burns. Buyers can compare how well a stove performs based on what's important to them, says EPA researcher Seth Ebersviller.
You may have mostly people cooking outdoors, in which case the indoor emissions aren't going to be as big of a deal. But maybe the fuel efficiency is very important because fuel is scarce. Whereas other places, they may have ample fuel, but they're mostly worried about how clean the stoves are burning because they don't have adequate ventilation in the houses.
Perhaps the most important thing is that they cook what people want, the way they want to cook it. Cheddar and his crew don't have an official test for that, but behind the lab, they occasionally do some unofficial testing.
They're delicious. Oh, yeah.
Steve Barragona, VOA News, Research Triangle Park, North Carolina.
Okay, so the work that we're doing at EPA is just a very small part of a much bigger international effort that is taking on this problem. So I think what we're doing is a small part, but it's an important part, but nevertheless a small part. So this problem of household air pollution from open fires and unventilated stoves is a multi-dimensional problem, but that means that there's also multiple opportunities for benefits. So, Lisa mentioned kind of a grand challenge with development of nuclear energy. And I think this is also kind of a grand challenge because this is a relatively new problem that's been recognized, and there's potential to really make big impacts in a number of areas. So this problem affects human health in many different ways. It affects the environment in many different ways. There are important social issues that are involved. Poverty is at the core of the problem. Women and children are disproportionately affected because, you know, around the world in traditional cultures, women do most of the cooking, most of the child care. And I'd like to draw your attention to these two photos on the screen here. The photo on top is from Guatemala, but this is a common practice around the world in many countries, a mother with a child on her back, protecting the child from danger, protecting the child from crawling into a burning open cooking fire and getting severely burned. Another big problem with open fires. And while the mother has the child on her back, the baby is exposed to the smoke, and lots of babies are dying from exposure to smoke with acute pneumonia and respiratory infections. So the photo on the bottom is from India. It's shows women carrying large loads of firewood, and this is also a common practice. Many areas of the world, we've seen this in many countries, and in some places women have to walk long distances to obtain firewood. In certain areas where security is a problem, women face great danger as they're collecting firewood. So, this, as mentioned before in the video, the Global Alliance for Clean Cookstove is coordinating this international effort to take this problem on, and the alliance has more than 1,500 partners now all around the world. The alliance is working to save lives and working on all those multiple benefits associated with clean stoves. The Alliance's goal is to have 100 million clean cook stoves in households by 2020. And the Alliance is on track to meet that goal, and they're doing it mostly through a market-based approach, including research and evaluation and development of standards. And at EPA, the work that I'm involved in is deeply involved with ISO, developing ISO standards for cook stoves. So the Alliance has had success, and there's been some great progress that's been made in the past few years. But there are some remaining obstinate challenges. And there are a number of challenges. For one thing, it's an engineering challenge to design and develop, build and manufacture cook stoves that are low cost so that poor people can afford them. And that, you know, these stoves have to be safe, robust, they have to last a long time, they have to be durable, they have to have low emissions of air pollutants, they need to be fuel efficient, and then most importantly, they need to meet the user needs. And those needs are very diverse. You know, there are diverse cultures around the world. They have very different needs. So one great cook stove is not going to solve all the problems. There are multiple solutions that are needed. And then it's not going to be effective in the long term to just give people a cook stove, because you know, we need an approach that is going to be sustainable over the long term. So this is a large scale problem that is likely, you know, to take a couple of decades to solve. And I think that, you know, that some of your students might be interested in this problem. The need is for not just for scientists and engineers, although there is a great need for scientists and engineers to be involved in taking on this problem, but there's a need for business people, for entrepreneurs, for advertisers, for people that understand behavior change, for cultural anthropologists, for lots of different disciplines. So we need people that can work together with between disciplines to solve this complicated problem. And so, you know, Ed mentioned suggested that maybe we should be asking students, what problems do you want to solve? And to me, this is one of those problems that maybe a student might be interested in. I think that it's very unlikely that a team of high school students is going to solve any problem by designing or inventing a new cook stove for a science fair project. But I think that it is very likely that some of the students that are in school today eventually will become involved in the movement to take on this problem, and that the creative thinking and the innovation that we need will come in the next generation. I hope that sometime in the near future that kids around the world will be able to talk with their grandparents or their parents or their teachers, and they'll be able to talk about how amazing it is that just a short time ago in history that almost 3 billion people in the world were cooking over cook fires. Thank you.
I'd ask all the presenters, if you come up here, and if there are any questions from the audience, raise your hand, we'll call on you. Presenters, if there are questions, if you could read back the question so that it can be recorded, that would be great. Okay. So, any questions? Yes, sir.
I have a question for Ms. Marshall about the future.
So the question is around subsidies and changing the future towards them. Right now, it is a heavily subsidized arena. You do have some startup companies that have joined the landscape, so to speak, and are looking at a smaller footprint. So that would be around your small modular reactors in particular, looking at NuScale, looking at TerraPower as company, at as examples of companies. And the idea there is to bring down the costs, smaller footprint in way of construction, also to get it through the regulatory process faster, and that then having an impact on the overall budget or the overall cost. And then that then forcing some of the larger companies to look at their particular footprint around costs and subsequently bringing them down. Right now, within the United States, you have private industry that are utilizing subsidies, whereas in other nations that are also selling their particular brand of nuclear power on the international market, there's more of a relationship between a blurring of the lines, so to speak, compared to us, where you can definitely see the regulatory, you can definitely see R&D, you can definitely see private companies. There's more of a merging, and that has then, because you are, for example, South Korea in particular, you've got the backing of government. It's really a government projects. France is in the same vein. And those have helped with overall costing. They're still grappling with it overall, but it helps. So we're also looking at some of these other international examples. You're welcome. So the question is around our Young Investigators Summer Program for students, rising juniors and rising seniors, and the costs associated with it. There is a cost associated overall, but we do have a scholarship program as well. So everything included, room, accommodations, meals, costs for the various trips that we're doing. It's $1,200 overall, but there is a scholarship that will cut that in half for those 3 weeks, and that is it is funded by a number of the utilities in this area. We go after funding there so that we can pass that on. And then in extreme cases, and I do that on a one-on-one basis, we'll even reduce the overall scholarship even. Tuition scholarship, I guess, would increase more, so the overall cost will be a lower.
I'm just curious as to where we are in the type of facilities that we could use that spent the fuel that still has that energy in it, and so we could use that as far as the United States. You said it was in France.
So the question is around spent fuel and how. I guess, why haven't we capitalized on the fact that we've got energy within our spent fuel quite just yet? It was initially a policy issue, dating back to the time of President Carter, and he was concerned with proliferation, in particular Cold War back in the 80s, and not necessarily, trying to do that balance and coming out on the American side to have a one-through system. That was not necessarily the case for the example that I gave of France and in way of reprocessing. We've come a ways with the technology to be able to do an accounting of our fuel, whether it be fresh fuel or spent fuel. The legislation has been lifted. However, I don't want to speak for the various utilities, but just to say that there probably will need to be some sort of initiative through the Department of Energy to kind of jumpstart closing that fuel cycle in a commercial manner. There has been and continues to be research work being done that is funded through the various national labs. So it hasn't, we haven't stopped, so to say, in the mid 80s, kind of freeze frame. But the commercialization of it, I think it will have to be spearheaded by kind of some of our research and development organizations.
I noticed you have the lead in green acoustic specialist skill set. that the architects who are building schools these days are aware of the acoustical pieces that you've researched? Do they implement those kind of facts into their buildings? Or?
Just like everything, it varies all over the map. When LEED was adopted, I think it was in 2007 version, they added, because of the problems they were seeing, especially in office buildings, actually, start with office buildings, but they figured the classroom was the best place to start. They were stripping out all the ceilings in offices and they started having problems, so they started with classrooms, and then when they saw that, they said, wait, we want to do a green building, and they get partway through the project and realize, what is this acoustics thing? So then that's when they started getting on board. And so anyone who's been doing green buildings for the last, you know, 10 years, around now, not quite 10 years, is aware of the classroom acoustics situation. They've been building schools with green buildings. So those groups are. But some of the folks who haven't been doing as much of that, I still get calls occasionally at the end of the project where they suddenly realize we need to meet this requirement and they don't know how to meet it. Oh, and the question was about whether green architects know about classroom acoustics. Go ahead.
Just piggyback on that, if a school district is getting ready to build a new building, would calling you be an interesting step, or would just check in with the architects we're working with?
So if a school was getting ready to build a building, would be speaking with me be a good idea? Yes, because I'm interested in educating people about the process, I mean, whether I get hired or not. But, I mean, certainly you should be asking the architects, and they should be aware of it if they're building a green building. And there are a lot of school systems who are adopting now, in entire states and a lot of cities who are adopting the classroom acoustic standard as part of the requirements. And I didn't mention this, but I'll mention it now. The Access Board is in the process. It takes time, but they've got it through to be adopted in the International Building Code. So it's just not ready for prime time yet. So
I have a question too for Joe. Okay. I know that EPA has a Tools for Schools program. I think it's focused mostly on air quality, but right. Do you know if does that have an acoustics component to it at all? Do you know?
I'll have to repeat the question. The I don't know if it has that. I know that we have a lot of educational outreach stuff that the Acoustical Society does, and also American Society of Hearing, ASHA. But they have a lot of tools as well. But no, I'm not aware of anything in the EPA program.
Yeah, so the question is, there a good site that students could go to find out more information about stoves and appropriate stoves for different cultures? And I would suggest these resources to start with. And I think there's a handout that I think may be posted online from these presentations, and this is included in the handout. So these websites would be good places to start with, and there's quite a lot of information online that you can find.
What's the good practice? Wait 30 seconds. All right. Well, thank you. Please join me in thanking our presenters.